Hey everybody, welcome back to theclinicaltrialsguru.com. Again, it's theclinicaltrialsguru.com. I'm still battling this cold, so thanks for sticking in there with me for this short video. So for those of you who don't know how this works, first of all, welcome. Second of all, please subscribe. Subscribe to my YouTube, subscribe to the blog. You see this hoodie I got on? Some people like it, some people don't. It's quarterly payments, gave me an SAE. So I have like three hoodies. I have two follow-up hoodies, which is kind of my slogan to make sure that you guys go out there and follow up on getting more studies, more patients, more PIs, whatever it may be. This one's just kind of more a jab at the contract and budgeting world. Okay, we all try to avoid quarterly payments in our contracts. So I thought it was kind of cool to do a sweater like this, although some people tell me it's a groaner. I get it, it's not that funny, but it's still something that conveys the message, sends the message home that quarterly payments suck, okay? So anyways, make sure you subscribe because I give these things away. That's the whole point of me talking about these hoodies. I give them away, I have contests, and if you don't like this one, you get the follow-up one. And then let me know if there's any other ideas you'd like to see made into either a t-shirt or a hoodie. From the clinical trial world, okay? So, here's a question I got today. So for those of you who don't know how this works, you send me your questions, dan@theclinicaltrialsguru.com, or you can find me on like all social networks and interact with me there. I'll make a video if I think it's a good question and I think others might benefit from it. And I'll keep you anonymous unless you specifically say, no, Dan, I want you to mention my name. All right, so this one, it says, hey Dan, I have a question for you. I will start auditing a bioequivalence CRO in India. And I would like to ask if you have an auditing checklist which can help me conduct this type of audit. So I have different kind of checklists because I do consulting myself. I work with a lot of CROs. I train a lot of CRAs. So we have tons of checklists. When it comes to an audit, especially a bioequivalency audit, especially in India, if you're auditing a CRO, the first thing, and this is because of all the recent press, the first thing you want to audit, the first thing you want to make sure that is not going on there is fraud. And India, actually, for those of you who don't remember, a couple years ago, they canceled all clinical trials there because of some unethical things going on where people were enrolled in studies without even knowing that they were enrolled in studies. They were given placebo, where it in the United States, if that same trial was being done in the U.S., they would never consider having a placebo arm because some of these were life-threatening medical conditions. So things like that, people enrolling people who didn't understand what they're signing. So I think they've gotten that cleared up now, but if you're an auditor auditing a CRO there, those are some obvious things you want to look at. So I would look at informed consents. I would look at things that would alert fraud, like, so your CRO is going to be choosing sites, right? They're probably managing a bunch of sites in India. Look at the enrollment numbers. Look at the top 20% of the sites, the top 20% of the high enrolling sites, and go to all the sites, look at where their protocol deviations are, see if there's any similarities amongst the sites, because now you've found maybe perhaps a protocol flaw. But more importantly than that, you want to know how the sites and the CRO are handling these protocol deviations. Then you want to look at the consenting process, make sure that in addition to the informed consent, and make sure those are done properly, make sure you find a documented process of informed consent. And be on the lookout for those copy and paste process of informed consent where it just looks like a template's being printed out. So what I would look at is looking to see whether there's a unique process. I mean, the process could be standardized, but each study participant's gonna have sort of like a different story in the process of informed consent. And yes, they may have an SOP that says this is our process of consent, but then also look in the PI notes and the coordinator notes for the screening visit and see what the story says, what the narrative says in the progress notes of the screening visits, particularly when it comes to the ICF, informed consent background. Then you want to make sure that you have some kind of medical history on these study participants. So a lot of study participants are being enrolled in studies in India. If you're looking for fraud, you're looking for made-up subjects, so subjects that don't even exist. So you want to have some kind of medical history that would show that this person does indeed qualify for this study. You shouldn't expect a medical history for everyone, but you should at least expect some attempts to obtain medical history. And from the high enrolling sites, you should have a fair amount of medical history there that's being captured. Also, for a bioequivalency study, I mean, the whole point of doing a bioequivalency study is to see if the generic drug works as good as the brand name drug. So there's a lot of PK samples, a lot of blood draws. Oftentimes they're every half an hour, every 15 minutes for like sometimes an 8 to 12 hour time period where you're drawing blood every so often. So make sure that the sites are documenting the exact time. Pay attention to round numbers, like if all the blood draws are at 11:30 or 11:35 or 11:40 or 11:45 and you're not seeing like 11:36, 11:37, 12:59, that's a red flag too, because there's no way that all the blood draws can be done at the same time. Also, in a high enrolling site, you want to make sure that if they have a bunch of visits in one day, and if it's the same person drawing the blood, they can't possibly be drawing two people's blood at exactly the same time. So those are things I would look at, especially because it's a bioequivalency study. The informed consent, I would look at the protocol deviations, I would see where the deviations are occurring, and I would look at the adverse event reporting, okay, and look at the adverse events as a whole, study-wide, and then look at the high enrolling sites. Are they showing similar adverse events? Because if a large number of the sites are showing certain adverse event, let's say upset stomach, and the high enrolling sites or one of them or two of them are not showing any upset stomachs, that just doesn't make sense with what the data would suggest. So I would pay attention to things like that. Look at their process of informed consent, look at the SOP, look at what the monitors caught at the visits. Are the monitors paying attention to these things, or are they not paying attention to these kind of things? That's what I would look at. That's what I would do for my audit. And try to find out if you can talk to the sites where they're recruiting the subjects from. Are the subjects able to give full consent? Are they aware of the study? Where is that in the process of informed consent? These are the things I would focus on if I was auditing a bioequivalency CRO in India. Thank you for the question. Let me know if you need more help. My consulting firm can help out with this as well. Dan at theclinicaltrialsguru.com. You can also call me, 949-415-6256. Take care.